Hello and welcome back, friends. Welcome back to another video session from Somos Biology. And in this video lecture, we want to talk about the fluorescence microscopy. Fluorescence microscopy principle, fluorescence microscopy basic explanation. So, in this series of microscopy lectures, we've been talking about the different types of microscopy and why we use them and their working mechanism. In this video, we want to talk about a different sort of microscopy where we use a visible light to excite fluorescence, or what we can say, excite chemical compounds that can produce fluorescence. Okay, and that excitation leads to the release of some other light, and we receive that light with the help of a detector, and we can visualize different structures, internal structures of the cell, with much greater details. That's why we use fluorescence microscopy. The key reason we use fluorescence microscopy is to visualize subcellular structures, the structures which are very small, and not only that, but also compartmentalization inside a cell. Because when we stain a cell, the different regions of the cell will receive the stain. Those regions which are much dense will receive more stain during the bright field microscopy. For example, nucleus will be heavily pigmented and heavily stained, where other organelles will also be stained. But we cannot distinguish between the different cytoskeleton structures inside the cell. We cannot mark them separately with the help of one or two different stains. And it's very difficult to work with multiple stains together. And the stains we have, either it's a blue color or red color, not more than that. So it's not good for us to mark one cell for different organelles and cytoskeleton components with the help of the few stains that we have available in our hand. So that's why we use fluorescence microscopy to mark different subcellular compartments and structures of the cell, and we get a beautiful image, and we can see that image under the microscope, and we can mark and identify different structures of the cell quite easily. So what happens in fluorescence microscopy? To understand fluorescence microscopy, you need to understand a concept that is known as the concept of fluorescence. Now there are some chemical compounds known as the fluorophore that can emit light when they receive some amount of light energy. They get excited, right? So those fluorophore who get excited upon receiving some light energy or receiving some photons. So you need to understand the particle property of light. The light has wave as well as particle property. In the light, bright field microscopy, dark field and phase contrast microscopy, we have seen the waveform of the light and how it is utilized in microscopy. But in fluorescence microscopy, we will see the particle form of light is being utilized. So the particle form of light is known as a photon, right? So the photon excites the fluorophore. For example, such kind of protein, there are proteins with this tag GFP, green fluorescent protein, or red fluorescent protein. Okay, there are different other chemical compounds which get excited with photon. So once photon excite those fluorophore, what happens to them is, actually, if I draw the atom, let's say in the atom, this is an electron, okay? This is an electron. This electron is present in the ground state. That is the most stable state for the electron to stay, the ground state. Now the moment they hit by the photon, so this is, let's say, the photon. Photon energy, this electron gets excited and this jumped into higher energy state. Higher energy state. So the electron jumped from the ground state to the higher energy state. So for this jump, they need this energy. From where they get the energy? From the photon. Now this electron from the higher energy state, because higher energy state, although they jump to the higher energy state, but this is very, very unstable, very unstable. So as it is very unstable, they quickly will come back to the ground state. So now the electron will jump to the ground state to become more stable. So now as the electron jump to the ground state, let me draw it with different color. Electron jump to the ground state, and during that process they release energy. They need to release energy because they got a lot of energy to jump, So while they are coming down, they will release the energy again as light. This light they release is known as the fluorescence. This is known as the fluorescence. Okay, this is the very basic way to explain fluorescence. So this fluorophore electron excites to the excitatory state, then return to the ground state. But there is one fundamental difference between this jump and coming down to the ground state. Okay, two situations are involved. So what we can call, we can easily explain this electron's movement from the ground state to the higher energy state. Here I draw only one higher energy state. There may be two, three different higher energy state. Okay, so while the electron is moving from ground state to the higher state, then further higher state, then coming down to the lower and the lowest state or ground state again, it can be explained with a diagram known as the Jablonski diagram. I'm not going to show you the Jablonski diagram here. I'm just going to explain the working principle of fluorescence microscopy here in details. Okay, but the Jablonski diagram helps us to understand this movement of electron from the lower energy state to the higher state and from higher to the lower. So this two event, high to low and low to high, okay, movement of electron. Now remember one thing, while the electron is moving from the lower energy state to higher energy state, they get excited with the wavelength which is not that big. But later on, when the electron jumps from the higher energy state to the lower energy state, they releases the energy. But now that energy will have, the light that they emit will have higher wavelength compared to the one that they receive to jump. So they have lower wavelength. Try to understand that. Lower wavelength means higher energy light, higher wavelength means lower energy light. So while they are going down, the energy of the light that they emit is relatively less than the energy they receive to jump to the higher energy state, and that's quite logical. So normally, let's say they get excited with the light 488 nanometer wavelength, so which will be something like blue range, right? 488 nanometer of wavelength of light excites that fluorophore, and the electron jumps from the ground state to the higher energy state. But when that same electron is moving from higher energy state to the ground state again, the wavelength of light they are emitting is 507 nanometers. Compared to the earlier wavelength, it's little more, okay, because it contains less energy. So this is near about green. This is about the green fluorescent protein. So if you think about a fluorophore who emits green light, that means they are not receiving, they are not excited by green light, they are excited by blue light. Got it? So for that reason, in fluorescence microscopy, we need to use a specific filter that can cut out most of the other electromagnetic radiation, only allow one type of wavelength of ray to pass. Okay, and that filter is known as excitation filter for fluorescence microscopy, because normally the light source we have produces white light composed of all the type of wavelength of light, right? But this excitation filter will only allow one type of wavelength of light to pass, all the other not to pass. This is one of the key for the fluorescence microscopy. This is one of the important component of the fluorescence microscopy. And then we need to make sure that the light that is coming out from the sample, because the sample is stained with the fluorophore, sample is injected with the fluorophore, so that this is a different kind of staining. Remember, in conventional light field microscopy training or bright field microscopy staining, we simply stain that with colored dye. But in this case, the dye is itself not colored, but when it's excited, it emits a colored light. Okay, so we need to use a different sort of mirror to gather the emitted light. The emitted light will be of higher wavelength, right? But the light that is exciting will be of lower wavelength. So let me draw the structure of this. Okay, let me draw it. I must draw it here. So in very basic way, this is the light source. We can write it as white light, okay? And this is the excitation filter. Via the excitation filter, what enters? Only one type of light. Let's say, let me change it with a color here, draw a color that will be blue. So this is blue. Only one color of light is allowed. There are multiple colors are present here in the white light. So the excitation filter only allow one type of wavelength of light to pass. And then this blue light is reflected with a reflect mirror is given there. This is known as a dichroic mirror, and it's very, very important. Dichroic mirror, very, very important. Now, as it's a mirror, it will reflect the blue light, right? The blue light will pass through the objective, and then finally, it will hit the sample. Specimen here. This is specimen. Okay, this is the objective. We have finally hit the specimen. And the specimen is with the fluorophore. Okay, let's say the specimen is with GFP. GFP is tagged inside some protein, along with some protein inside the cell, okay, of the specimen. And this is where the detector is present. So the structure of this microscope is seen a little different, right, compared to the other one. So the light coming in, the excitation filter, let me write it, the excitation filter will only allow one type of light to pass, that is blue in this case of 480 nanometer. Then it's reflected by the dichroic mirror through the objective. It reaches the sample, it reaches the specimen, and once it excites the specimen's fluorophore, the fluorophore will emit fluorescence, another light. And now the light that will emit is the green light. I don't have any green marker and it is not visible, so I'll use red to explain, but actually it releases green light. So now the sample releases green light, and the green light will pass through the objective, finally passing through the finally they will hit the dichroic mirror. Now this is the most important part. Why we call it as a dichroic mirror? Because this is a specific type of mirror, special type of mirror. It will allow one type of wavelength to be reflected, but the other type of wavelength to pass through. So the dichroic mirror will allow this red, will allow this blue colored light, that is of 488 nanometer, not to pass, to be reflected, but it will allow this green light of 507 nanometer to pass through it, and this light will hit the detector. And now the detector can detect the presence of the fluorophore in the sample, and we can visualize the green color in the sample in that location from where the light is coming. This is the beauty of the dichroic mirror. That's why I told you this is a very, very important structure in here. Okay, so remember, this dichroic mirror's role is to allow one type of light to pass through it, the other wavelength of light to be reflected. In this case, as we know that rule that while excited, when the electron is jumping from the higher state to the lower state or the ground state, the wavelength of light that they emit is larger, is bigger, because it carries less energy. And that wavelength of light is allowed to move through the dichroic mirror and hit the detector, and the detector received it. And that is how you are going to see the fluorophore or fluorescence coming out of a specimen which is fixed in the slide. So this is the idea of fluorescence microscopy. And the fluorescence microscopy that we clearly see is used with this two important part, the excitation filter and dichroic mirror, two important element of a fluorescence microscope. Okay, and in this case, you remember the objective is a lens where the dual way light goes in and out with the help of the objective, and the sample specimen is present in the bottom. Now, this fluorescence microscopy will help us to find out beautiful pictures of subcellular compartments and subcellular organelles inside the cell, and they are very, very well enough to understand the structures of the cellular organelles and cellular compartments quite well. And at the same time, in one specimen, we can stain it with multiple fluorescence tags and we can see multiple different coloration in that sample specimen. So this is a picture I'm showing you about the fluorescence microscopy, and this fluorescence microscope gives us a lot of details, singular details about the different organelles and structures, and then we can combine all the pictures together to get a bigger picture of one big picture with multiple fluorescent tag at the same time. So we can get a picture of individual fluorescence independently, then we can merge those pictures to get a all-in-one picture with multiple fluorophore tags. So that is the beauty of fluorescence microscopy. But the fluorescence microscopy has a limited capability in terms of the different focal plane of the specimen, because the specimen, as we are looking in depth, in details, we sometimes need to look into the different structures which are present on the surface of the specimen, then on the bottom of the specimen, and somewhere middle in the specimen, because the specimen has a thickness, although it's very tiny, but it still has a thickness, and the fluorescence cannot give us the detail about the thickness with the help of this conventional fluorescence microscopy. But there is a specific modified version of fluorescence microscopy where we can find out the light rays or fluorescence ray coming out from the different depth of field of the specimen to give us much more detail about the different depth of the structures of the same cell, which help us to construct a 3D image of the cell as well. And that is known as the confocal microscopy. So we are going to talk about confocal microscopy in the next video. But for now, this is all about the fluorescence microscopy. I believe you understand the video. If you like this video, please hit the like button, share this video with your friends, and subscribe to our channel to get more and more videos like that. Thank you. Bye.